you will need to go shopping for the best playground equipment. The principal accidentally lost his budget and can't remember the order of his numbers. He remembers the numbers 2, 3, 6, and 9. He needs your help to make a budget and design the new playground. So today we're going to do task 3. Now we're actually at the designing of the playground.
So the first thing we did was review what the actual scenario and the task would be, and then we went over the rubrics so that they had a clear picture of what the expectations were for them in order to receive a proficient or exemplary score on the task. And we talked about what it means to be a mathematician and to think like a scholar, so I reviewed what those things would be.
Andrew, what does the mathematician do before he starts?
Think about the problem.
Think about the problem. Francisco.
Ask myself what sitting
strategy
will I use.
Ask myself which strategy will
I knew when I started the task they were lacking a lot of the skills that they needed to complete it, but went ahead and did it because it's more of a formative assessment anyways. Give me a clear picture of exactly where we're at and what I need to reteach before we get to the post-test for the unit.
Okay, look at this digit. What digit is this? First tell me the digit.
2.
What place is that digit in? 200, so it's value, or it's in the hundreds, so its value is? 200. Can I add this from the hundreds place and this from the thousands? If I did that, would my answer be accurate or inaccurate? Inaccurate. You need to fix it. You got to line up your numbers correctly.
My biggest role was just to be the facilitator. They're very used to someone telling them first do this, next do that, each step along the way, which there's a place for that. I've done a lot of that leading up to the task, but now when we got to part A, I really wanted to step out as much as I could and try to just facilitate the conversation or ask them guiding questions that might cause them to reflect or rethink maybe what they were doing.
Yeah, and then you're gonna put the two, and then you can put the two right here.
Oh, so you're showing him how to what?
Do it correctly.
Okay, and use what?
A good strategy.
Regrouping? Okay, all right, let Ethan finish up.
And then you're gonna, like, see, this is gonna be 8 plus 8 is 16. Yeah, and then you're gonna
put the 1 right here to the 9.
And you're gonna put it
and
right
that
there.
Equals 19. Wait, no. 13.
Now we add 399.
Did you and Ethan come up with the same solution?
Yes.
Yes, and Deja as well?
Yes.
Okay, so we're getting Dion caught up.
Ultimately, I'm trying to lead them to the correct answer in the end, but I'm focusing way more on what the process is to get there and how to develop their thinking skills rather than just, you know, do I have the right answer, yes or no.
So what do you think would be a good solution? Where do you think you've gone wrong? I see you have a whole list of items here. Do you know you have enough money to buy all of these things?
Yeah, because we bought a little bit of more stuff, and we're checking our work.
Okay, so you're checking your work, but let me ask you, you've made a list, right? And it said, create a list of the items you selected, and you organize them from least to greatest. Did we do that step?
So for part C, they were to list each item they purchased, the quantity that they selected of that item, and then come up with a total cost, and then subtract that from the 9,600 that they started with, just like you would in a check register, and then do that item by item until they got to what their remaining balance was.
Subtract that.
Should you both come up with the same solution at the end?
Well, subtract four minus three. You subtract?
So if you want to start at the top and she wants to start at the bottom of her list,
could you subtract 4 minus 3? No.
It's absolutely okay.
You can't because there's just three digits in the 3, and there's 4 in that. And 4 minus 3.
With 3, you can't do nothing.
Huh? 6 minus 9, you can't do that, so you have to borrow from the 2.
This?
Yeah, you have to borrow from the 2.
I want to hear less talking and I want to hear more.
No, you have to put them in from here because you borrowed from the 2. Now the 6 has to become 16, so you
cross it out?
No, you don't cross it out. You put a little one next to it, a little one.
I mean, I gained even more information from the task than I had before. I knew they were struggling, and I could tell that from activities and assessments that I've done along the way, but I learned much more about exactly where the struggles are, and even in specific individuals, who's struggling with what.
Can you subtract 7 minus 7.
They had a very difficult time with the subtraction with regrouping, and part of that is because it required them to subtract across the zeros, so having to regroup with the zeros from the beginning, from the very first item, for a lot of them threw them off track immediately.
So the zero becomes what? An 8? Where am I getting an 8 from?
Sometimes I'll ask them to justify their answer, even though I know it's incorrect, because I want to know what their thought process is, because that will help me reteach later when I know what they're thinking. Because sometimes what they're thinking makes sense to them, but led them to the wrong answer, but it's much easier to reteach when I know what their approach to the problem was. When we started the task, I knew the students were still having difficulty with regrouping, so I expected that most of them would score in the progressing range. But what I found at the end is they were able to complete all components of the task, and many students scored in the proficient range.